Yeah, they're coming right now. They're coming right now? Yep, they're coming right now.
Welcome, everybody, to the Mark B. Segal Theater Center here at the Broadway Center. CUNY, my name is Frank Henschel. I'm the executive director and director of programs together with Andrew Riddle here from the Segal Theater Center. The Segal Center bridges academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And it is our great pleasure to present something what we feel very strongly about as a great American art, like jazz. In American Expressionism, there is the art form of tap dancing. And we once had a fantastic event over 2 days. We streamed over 20 hours of material from the very, very beginning of tap dance, the very earliest records one could find, to the kind of global reach tap dancing has now. And the guy who did this was Brian Seibert. And someone said he's working on a book. And this was 4 or 5 years ago. And he had started to work on this book in 2001. And now finally, it just came out in 2015, I think a month ago. And this is,
Tuesday.
Well, this is Brian. And I had said to him, whenever your book is ready, please do come back to us. This is such a significant field that's overlooked, and it needs to be more the limelight and stage light of the theater and performance world nationally, but also internationally. And he said, fine, and he just had a great review that came out this morning, I think, in the New Yorker, it's been reviewed already in the New York Times, and Harper's, and many, many others, so we are in for a real treat, and we have an in with Brian, who now also is next to Alistair, you know, one of the significant New York Times dance critic, which also, at the time, he was writing some of it, but it also has grown into it, and so this is the next step. The book is here, and it's a very big one. So if you are an aficionado and you really like this, I think this is something you must have on your bookshelf, and we are really curious to hear a little bit more from Brian. Last time he was here, we showed visual material for today, so this time we will hear from him a little bit about the process as well as some discoveries he made along the way. With us also tonight, we have a performer, Ayodele Casel, who's over there, and she said, I'm just gonna go out there and dance and be on the floor. And so we will begin with a performance, as we always do, we have a performative element, and then Brian will give a 30, 35 minute talk. We will have a little conversation, and we all hopefully will join in. This is such a great audience. Thank you all for coming out, especially before Thanksgiving and weekend, but it is something truly unique, we think, and thank you for being such a good audience. There will be a little reception in the room after the evening. It will not be longer than 90 minutes, which will be a little bit shorter. If you have a cell phone, just take it out for 1 second. I'll do the same. And let's make sure it's on off, so it doesn't really ring. And now we'll start the evening. Again, thank you all for coming. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Ayodele. But here you go. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. And thank you, Frank, and the Segal Center for hosting. So I have written a history of tap dancing. It took me a very long time. When I learned from Frank that Frank was asking me to deliver a lecture named after a distinguished expert in Eastern European theater, I considered talking about tap behind the Iron Curtain. It actually existed. And I wrote about it in my book, even. These are the Gusakov brothers. This is Carnival Night. It's a Soviet film. It's like the Soviet It's a Wonderful Life, the one you watch, or did watch, you know, for New Year's. Why are they pretending to be Mexican? Because that way they are not doing the capitalist American boom. This is like folk dance or something. Anyway. I'm not gonna talk about that. Instead, I thought I'd do kind of a director's DVD commentary about my book, a little talk about some of the intellectual challenges that I faced when writing it. I hope this will come across as more than just me complaining. I hope it'll be illuminating about tap history or even the writing of history in general. I'll try not to get too dry or technical. I will share some entertaining clips with you, and at the end, the very fine Hoover Ayodele will be back to dance for you some more, and I may just have to join her. This is such a beautiful floor. First, so the challenges of writing a history about tap dancing. The term tap dancing came into wide use in the 1920s. That's Ned Wayburn, who may have introduced the term, and that's him in his factory. He had a chorus girl factory in the 20s. But the practice in names goes back a lot further back than that. I wanted to see how far back it goes, how far back it went, and where it comes from, and how it developed. First problem. Unlike, say, literature or painting, tap doesn't leave a record itself. If you want to know how people danced before the 20th century, you have to rely on static drawings, and above all, on words. Now, I'm a writer. If I didn't believe in the power of words to evoke and make sense of dance, I wouldn't have written this book. But there are lots of problems with what was written about tap's ancestral forms. The writing is often imprecise and contradictory. Generally, it's just scarce. Unlike court forms, tap emerged from below, developed by people, slaves, immigrant Irish, who weren't necessarily literate. And the people who were literate often ignored the practices of these people, or condescended to them, or wrote about them in misleading ways. Consider this story I tell in the book, a quote from James Smith, telling about an event he witnessed while a slave in Texas just before the Civil War. By way of explaining how good and kind his master was, Smith spoke of how there was dancing on the plantation most Saturday nights, how his master built a platform for, quote, jigging contests, and how the colored folk came from miles around to compete. He spoke of a fellow slave, Tom, as, quote, the jigginest fellow that ever was. Now, pardon the dialect here. I'll talk about that in a minute, but this is what's on the page. Everyone around tried to get somebody to best him. He could put the glass of water on his head and make his feet go like trip hammers and sound like a snare drum. He could whirl around and such, all the movement from his hips down. Now it gets round that a fellow has been found to beat Tom, and a contest then arranged for Saturday evening. There was a big crowd and money on bet, but master bets on Tom, of course. They starts jigging. Tom starts easy and a little faster and faster. The other fellow doing the same. They gets faster and faster, and that crowd emigillin. Gosh, they're em excitement. They just keep a gwin. It looked like Tom done found his match, but there's one thing he ain't done. He ain't made a whirl. Now he does it. Everybody holds his breath, and the other fellow starts to make the whirl, but just a spoonful of water sloughs out of his cup, so Tom am the winner. Now, if this isn't tap, it sure sounds like an ancestor. Like most of the testimony about slave dance given by slaves themselves, Smith's account entered the historical record in the form of an interview conducted by members of the Federal Writers Project in the 1930s. In it, the 77-year-old Smith is remembering his very early childhood. He's talking to a representative of the government, most likely a white person in the segregated South. The words on the page are that interviewer's transcription of Smith's dialect, what the interviewer thought he heard, or maybe what Smith thought the interviewer expected or wanted to hear. Caveats aside, what's happening in Smith's story? This contest, was it the master's idea, or the slaves? The glass on the head, the hip-down action, the feet behaving like trip hammers and sounding like a snare drum up on the platform. Where did these practices come from? Smith calls it jigging, a word that seems to point to Ireland, even as the lineage of the slaves points to Africa. So in the book, I tried my best to answer those questions. But then there's the biggest complication of all, which is race. Because of the history of race in America, starting with slavery, all of the evidence seems tainted. When we're reading whites writing about slave dances, or 17th century Europeans writing about African dance, or 18th century Englishmen writing about dance in colonized Ireland, we have to read through prejudice. So, for example, here is a 1846 journal entry by the esteemed Harvard historian Francis Parkman, describing two slaves chained together, dancing as another slave beats on a banjo. Quote, "They never seem to have known a care. Nothing is on their face but careless, thoughtless enjoyment. Is it not safe to conclude them to be an inferior race?" This, to say the least, seems misleading. What else were whites missing? There's an African and an African-American tradition of danced mockery. When white observers made fun of the slaves' quote affectations, were they missing slave mockery of white affectations? Much writing about slave dancing is sarcastic. It's often very hard to tell what is straight and what is a joke and who the joke is on. Questions permeate the historical record. The terms themselves are very slippery. Take pigeon wing. That's a term that former slaves used to label their dancing. One former slave said it was like animal mimicry, some kind of being like a pigeon. Another said that it was about cracking your heels together in the air. Another source associated with rowdy frontiersmen. And yet another said it was a French dancing school step popular in New York ballrooms. So what was it? Or the jig, for example. I go into the use in England in the 17th century as a common name for music and dance of informal social occasions, and I explain its later association that it developed with Irish dance. But then what to make of the American slaveholder who testified that, quote, "the jig was an African dance, and a famous one at old times before more refined notions began to prevail." It's the same situation with other terms, juba and double shuffle and buck dancing and the breakdown. I try to lay this out for the reader, the various etymological explanations, as a kind of caveat about what we can know about the past. And I try to show how all of that slipperiness, in my view, amounts to evidence of a lot of mixing. But that's not even getting into blackface minstrelsy, which is how all of these progressive dances became theatrical, which is to say how they became tap dancing. Blackface minstrelsy, which is white men putting burnt cork on their faces and in some measure pretending to be black, was the most popular form of entertainment in America through the 19th century. I could give several lectures about its complexity, because the closer you look, especially in the early stages, in the early 1830s, 1840s, the more strange and ambiguous it seems. It was mockery, yes, and the distortions of prejudice, but also passionate emulation and identification. It's really totally fascinating stuff, and at the core of American culture, but in an empirical sense, it causes more historical problems. The minstrels and their promoters spread stories of the accuracy and fidelity of their mimicry, stories we should be skeptical about. How accurate, how authentic were the minstrels? It's hard to tell, partly because of the problems I already described about the evidence of slave dancing. We don't have, you know, that side to judge it against. And then minstrelsy makes all of that worse because it was so popular. The writings and drawings about slave dance are very much influenced by minstrelsy, so it's hard to tell. You know, it's a chicken and egg problem, sort of. I don't know how well you can see these. This is a representation of slave dancing from a illustration of a escaped slave's memoir on the top. And then over here is the cover image from a minstrel song. Your two cover image of a minstrel song, and this is supposedly a representation of people dancing not so far from here on the East River Captain Market. You can see, you know, so much of the visual representation is the same, so it's hard to tell where is it coming from, what's the real source, what's convention, just to give you a taste. And it gets more and more complicated. After the war, freed blacks went into show business, and they did minstrel shows, sometimes in blackface, adopting conventions of minstrelsy, possibly undermining prejudices, possibly confirming them. This too is rich stuff, but also for me, another source of frustration. I want to see and hear and judge for myself, which is why, historically, the invention of film comes as a great relief. A shot at the Edison Studios in 1894. It was distributed as the Piccadilly Dance, with catalog copy describing it as, quote, a scene of southern plantation life before the war, a jig and breakdown by three colored boys. But the catalog also identifies these men by name, Joe Rastus, Denny Tolliver, Walter Wilkins, and also as backup for the white soubrette Lucy Daly, in the passing show on Broadway. In other words, they weren't just colored boys doing what colored boys do. They were professionals hired to represent that. It also shows you what Edison thought people would want to watch. But nevertheless, it's an amazing thing. We can see it, finally. Their timing is sort of visible, the pulse and the clapping and the balance of the bodies. I can't actually imagine the rhythms they're making, though. And that's generally true of silent film. Half of the art of tap is missing. What about the other half, the music half? This is a wax cylinder from 1901. Is that tapping? Is that typing? It's a little hard to tell. Kind of sounds like a soft shoe to me. But very little tap was recorded in audio form, possibly because people didn't think it was music. I think there was also some problems with audio technology. Recording drums in this period is not very good either. And that dearth is a problem if you're trying to retrace stylistic and rhythmic development the way I was. You really have to go into the 20s before you get much tap recording. I'm going to play something here, and anyone who hasn't read my book yet, let's see if you can guess who it is just by listening. Thank you. big hint coming up soon. Seen and heard us there dancing. And that's because sound film finally took off at the end of the 20th, which is a great boon for me trying to write about. It means you can have things like this. And because that exists, 1932, I can do something like this. I'm going to read you the end of the first time that Bill Robinson appears in my book. There was more to Robinson's act than carefree abandon. A key part of it originated back in 1918 when Robinson saw some friends in the audience at the palace and danced down the stairs to greet them. Thus was his stair dance born, or so he said sometimes. Other times he said it came to him while he was dreaming of a different palace in England. In that dream, he stood at the bottom of the staircase, waiting to be knighted. I didn't like the idea of just walking up, he recalled, so I thought I'd dance up. I danced up the stairs to the throne, got my badge, and danced right down again. He said that his best steps always came to him in his dreams. These stories are probably apocryphal, which isn't to say that they hold no truth. Professional black and white dancers have been clogging on stairs since at least the 1880s. King Rastus Brown claimed that Robinson stole the idea from him, though Brown almost certainly stole it from somebody else. Notwithstanding such antecedents, Robinson was viciously possessive. There's many a tale about what he did to those who dare used stairs. Stop the act mid-performance, slap the offender, pull out a pistol. Once, when the dancer Eddie Rector replaced him in a show, Robinson sent him a cablegram, warning him not to do the stair dance on penalty of death. His effort to protect the claim was largely futile. When he attempted to secure a patent on the stair routine, the U.S. Patent Office denied the application. In the early years, he danced up and down stage stairs. Soon, he had a portable staircase built. The stairs were central to his act, his vaudeville gimmick, but they must have been important to him for another reason. They magnified the essential strengths of his dancing. The staircase was symmetrical. It was two staircases joined back to back, a terraced pyramid, five steps up, five steps down. Each step was just large enough to accommodate Robinson's 2 feet, and the connected top step serves as a platform. The entire staircase rose to the height of Robinson's ribs, and a triangle of empty space underneath it made for a resonant drum. Upon these steps, Robinson could portion out his own. What the stairs did for Robinson was reveal how he played with the structure of the music through how he played with the structure of the staircase. He would become known for bringing tap up on its toes. In contrast to the flat-footed style of dancers such as King Rastus Brown, Robinson carried his weight over the balls of his feet and drew up his carriage from there in a direct line. It's as if he were trying to balance a glass of water on his head, as if he had been studying clog dancing made easy. His arms swung more freely than a clogger's, but for the most part, he kept his feet neatly underneath him, which is why his dancing fits so well on the stairs. The small space emphasized the extraordinary efficiency of his movements, his impeccable control. The height gave the floor-bound dance a vertical dimension, amplifying his rhythmic wit. The staircase was an extension of his instinct to dramatize. It used the eye to direct the ear. From the back of the theater, you could perceive that it was an instrument, each stair of which rang a slightly different note. The tonal distinctions were subtle, but then Robinson was a subtle dancer. The Iceland Shoe Company in Chicago made his clog special order, 20 or 30 pairs a year. If one sole split, he discarded the pair. Using shoes with different levels of wear would have compromised the perfect balance of his sound. He liked to challenge people to go beneath the stage and try to distinguish his right foot from his left, an easy task with many dancers, impossible with him. Robinson wore out shoes by dancing often, not by dancing hard. Wood met wood, two equals. It was a warm sound, precise, but with a soft center. His taps were even, measured. Indescribably liquid, wrote the critic, Robert Benchley, like a brook flowing over pebbles. The Chicago Daily News compared them not just with the steady beat of a racehorse's feet, but with quail's wings. Not with firecrackers, but with firecrackers heard in the distance. Audiences leaned in to listen. To imagine since Robinson's stair dance, first hear a song such as Old Folks at Home. Here's where the footage comes in. Swanee River played in ragtime. He starts from the ground with a time step, making accents with sharp nudges to the face, the bottom stair. Adjusting the angle of his bowler, he hops up a couple levels and back. Then he repeats the rhythm by swinging his right leg up and skipping it down, turning the stairs into a tilted xylophone. His leg momentum spins him around, and he hits an upbeat en route before finishing out the phrase facing his instrument. The next measure he splits between tapping on the floor and patting the stairs with his foot. His knuckles handle the repeat. Then he's up and down the stairs, half a phrase on one step, the remainder on his neighbor. The complexity of the rhythms builds, then subsides, then builds again. The brook flows over more pebbles or fewer, but it does not cease flowing. All along, Robinson's arms swing loosely, now drooping for a drawl show of relaxation, now pushing out small circles as if to say, that's nothing. Sometimes he concentrates on one stair and sneaks in a tap on the stair below it, or he slips a tap between stairs as he ascends. He scales the stairs backwards with just as much ease. For a while, he uses the top platform to showcase quick rolls and drum-tight wings. He keeps packing in more stairs per bar, subdividing the beat with stairs. By the end, he's running up and down the stairs. That's all he's doing, running up and down the stairs. But it's music and it's magic, and he knows it as he struts off the stage. The dance thrills, but not with acrobatics or speed or even inspired rhythms. For much of the number, Robinson's rhythms are metronomic. He can be plain, but you can trust him. You can relax. The stairs are a stunt that conceals its daring. As generations of imitators would learn to their grief, the properties of the staircase that magnified Robinson's mastery equally magnify the slightest imperfection. Robinson's timing, his metronome sense, was legendary. Dancers tell a story in which he had his musicians cut out for 3.5 minutes while he continued dancing. After the allotted time, the musicians came back in, cued by a metronome that Robinson couldn't hear. He was exactly on beat. It was another sense of Robinson's timing, though, that would prove most consequential. Unlike, say, King Rastus Brown's stair routine, Robinson's signature number was filmed, most fully and simply, in the 1932 all-black short, Harlem's Heaven. Bill Robinson came in at the right time. Or perhaps it would be more accurate to say that when the right time came, he was still there, on beat and in step. So dance writing shouldn't always do that level of moment-to-moment description, but that's another peril, it's the opposite peril. But it's so nice to be able to do it at all at this point. I'll give you another example, but I'll do it in reverse order this time. I'll read and then we'll watch. This is about the Nichols brothers. The parents of the Nichols brothers played in pit bands and were, by all accounts, excellent musicians. She a stride piano adept, he a show drummer who juggled with his sticks. The children of such parents couldn't escape jazz, whether rocking in a bassinet in the orchestra pit or loitering in the wings each day after school. Starting in Mobile, the family trekked from theater to theater, Chicago to Winston-Salem. In Baltimore, young Fayard saw Ginger Jack Wiggins do a split and tried it himself, sliding all the way down and squeezing back up without using his hands. His muscles were young and elastic, and it came easy. The time step, however, Fayard initially found difficult. Enlisting his sister and his brother, he formed an act. Leonard Reed, who came through Baltimore in 1926, remembered that the Nicholas kids stopped the show there, especially when Harold, the youngest, toddled out. The family settled in Philadelphia, where the parents ran the pit band at the Standard Theater, calling themselves the Nicholas Collegians and dressing in preppy white sweaters. Fayard observed and absorbed. Fayard was in everybody's way in the wings, watching everybody, Reed recalled. He could do anybody he wanted to do. Fayard practiced in his living room, practiced on the fire escape, practiced in his dreams. If I thought of something, he once recalled, to keep from losing it, I'd start performing it. Another tactic was to teach his brother. His bookish sister bowed out early. 7 years younger than Fayard, Harold was a preternatural mimic who entertained the family with his Louis Armstrong imitation. At first, Harold also struggled with the time step, but the logic clicked one day while he was washing the dishes. Keeping up with his brother was no sweat. They made their debut over the airwaves on the popular radio program, the Horn and Hard Art Children's Hour. It would be their last amateur show. The boy's father insisted on professional engagements. And from then on, it was the typical early life of the tap star story accelerated. Everywhere, they stopped the show. Everywhere, they earned the next clothing spot. One night near the end of 1931, Frank Schiffman, the manager of the Lafayette, knocked on their dressing room door. The whole family packed for Harlem. They went to the Lafayette Theater, and their Lafayette debut led to their being cast in the Vitaphone short Pie Pie Blackbird. According to their biographer, Constance Vallis Hill, Fayard is 18 in the film, Harold 11. They could pass for much younger. Fayard told the jazz historian Marshall Stearns that he and his brother were 14 and 7, which at least looks more accurate. Harold comes up to Fayard's lower ribs. The brothers play pickaninnies to Nina Mae McKinney's mammy figure as she sings to them about a blackbird pie she's making for the master. In close-up, the pie peels back to reveal Ubi Blake's band cooking up some jazz and pastry chef uniforms. And soon the Nicholas brothers skip on for a challenge dance to set before King. Fayard opens with Over the Tops. That's a step I explained earlier, and maybe we'll do later. Bent way over, his limbs crossing and slashing, far more than the steps step requires. He finishes on the toe tip. Yeah, screams his little brother, hopping to the beat on his toes and screaming, yeah, for himself. When Fayer tries to break in, Harold brushes him off. He's not done yet. And punches out over the top's pipe, even closer to horizontal than his brother managed. Fayer's next turn, building intensity by repeating a step, crests with no hand splits. I can take that, Harold yells, executing over the tops and trenches with such reckless force that he's either going to lose a tooth or levitate. Gravity seems to operate differently on his insubstantial mass. The band accelerates and the brothers' time steps are obscured by smoke. When the smoke clears, two dancing skeletons remain, a disturbing joke about hot jazz. The routine is a summation of 20's tap in 2.5 minutes, everything that Fayer assimilated at the Standard Theater. The phrases are Robinson tidy, 8-bar segments divided into 3 in a break or tiled with 1 step, but these brothers hit the ground hard. Stories of their stopping every show need no more proof than this clip. Yet the special charm of the number lies in their attitude toward each other, which really does feel fraternal, loving with a strong undercurrent of rivalry. Fayer's dancing is more complicated, physically and rhythmically, shifting in and out of double time, but his artistry is trumped by Harold's charisma. The elder brother, the gentle one who has choreographed the dance, gets upstaged by his impish pupil. Teacher looks pleased. Shorts, intended for black audiences in segregated theaters. Robinson did one Hollywood film in 1930, but blacks were mostly ignored in the early years of movie musical. Later in the 30s, of course, Robinson found big fame in Shirley Temple movies, playing the faithful servant. She was the biggest box office star of all, and he became a big star in the same movie. Nicholas Brothers, too, had a career in mainstream Hollywood movies as kids and then later as adults in the 40s. Like most black tap dancers, they were segregated from the plot, no speaking roles, And especially in their case, that's an injustice. Harold seems to me like leading man material. He's a little kid there, but he grew up a very handsome, sexy guy. And there were other tap dancers considered great by tap dancers who were barely or never filmed. On my YouTube channel, that's what the eye hears, you can find audio of the highly influential Eddie Rector performing at the Cotton Club. But what's really amazing to me is how much was preserved in the 30s and 40s and 50s. So much more than, say, what we have of ballet or modern dance in those years. The major figures are there, the minor figures, and where earlier in history, tap was disadvantaged by being the popular form, in the heyday of Hollywood, that status became a huge advantage. There were just so many movie musicals were pumped out. You have no idea how many terrible movies I watched, like watching for 2 minutes and the tap dancers a minute. And those films preserved the art so that I can analyze and describe it and talk about stylistic developments and individual styles and make rankings and all the other things that a critic and historian usually does. And not only that, but you can see it, and you can watch it on YouTube. Also, my website, whattheeyehears.com, I have a little like primer that you can watch videos to start with, a top 20. And it's not just that, it's also tap dancers who came later, tap dancers who are just starting now. They can draw upon that history in a pretty direct way. That profusion of filming ended when tap went out of fashion on Broadway in the 40s. And then Hollywood followed suit in the 50s, and then as the movie musical itself went out of fashion, and that had a consequence. All of these, in the 60s and 70s, you had all these movies from the past that made tap seem like an art of the past as well. And this during a period when tap was dormant, persisting, still developing, but underground, under the radar. One big reason was the rise of television, which took away a lot of jobs for tap dancers by keeping people at home, not in the theaters and nightclubs. But on the other hand, tap preserved a lot of tap dancers too. The great Peg Leg Bates never appeared in a movie, but he was on the Ed Sullivan Show 19, 21 times, something like that, so we can still watch him. And that's true of many others. Later in the 70s, 80s, we had videotape, and then you have a lot of footage suddenly, especially more obscure dancers. And then most recently, you've had the advent of the internet and YouTube, where in a sea of footage, there's a rich library of tap history and tap present, a usable path for tap dancers to study and for everyone else to enjoy, and also a free and easily accessible video companion for my book. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie, so much. That was enlightening. You can see it's just a little spark of the entire book and what all he writes for. But maybe we'll sit down and have a little conversation. Maybe Ayodele, you come and join us. And if you take the mic from the podium, so you can take it off, and maybe one more microphone. So, well, first of all, congratulations again, Brian, for getting the book done. It's a long work. You worked really hard on it for a very long time. I'm a big fan of slow cooking. People do too much, produce too fast. And this is really an example of a great work, of a dedicated work. And we also publish books. You have our highest respect for what you do. So thank you. And isn't it great that there is a book out now on tap dancing? Thank you. Is it really the first real book at it?
There have been other
small ones, but it's astonishing. Yeah. Maybe tell us a little bit about your journey. What did you have the idea of, and why is it so close to your heart?
Well, I did start as a tap dancer when I was very young, maybe about 6 years old. I was in a suburb of Los Angeles and really, really bad at soccer. And my mother just thought that dance lessons might improve my coordination, and ended up liking the the dance class much better than soccer, and continued with that. So that was, you know, one of the things I did. And then as a young writer, my youth, 15 years ago, looking for a topic, I started going to these jam sessions at Swing 46. I think you might have been there at that time, club in Midtown Manhattan, and I was just amazed by this whole realm of tap that I really wasn't aware of. I think when I was a kid, I never thought of it as making music, which it clearly is, and also just the amazing range of people that were at those jams. There's like 80-year-olds and 4-year-olds and people who were terrible and people who were the best in the world, and you know, and people from all over the world, like huge numbers of Japanese people. It's extremely big in Japan. I just wondered, where does this come from? What is this about? And I got obsessed.
Well, tell us a bit about the journey. What did you discover? What surprised you?
Everything surprised me. I'm not even really sure where to start. It was just a lot I learned about, not just about tap, but really about American culture and the history of race relations in this country. That tap, one of the things that was so exciting to me about the subject was that it's so central to American popular culture, and then it goes all the way through from before the beginnings of this, you know, before we were a country. All the way through, as I said, blackface minstrelsy and vaudeville and Broadway and Hollywood musicals, and it was in everything, you know.
Yeah, no, truly, and it is such a quintessential sort of American art, and I think this was long overdue to have a look at it. When we did the screening of the 2 days, as far as we know, it was the very first time at any American university at the Americas, where tap dance was put in a focus. And even now, you will have a hard time to find it, you know, most probably in seminars or being taught. And your book, which is the most the closest look so far, I think, you know, in history of publishing about it. Why do you think it's been such a long time? Why is it so difficult? Why hasn't that been done before?
Oh, I don't know. I think, well, it's hard. It took me a long time, because you have to... You have to be someone who can write about dance and about music. That's a challenge. And then, I don't know, there's like a, in terms of what you're talking about being taken seriously, some of that is built into the dance too. That like there's a aesthetic of making it look easy. I think people don't take it seriously maybe for that reason. Also, there's an association with amateurness. All these movies in the 30s where, you know, there's some kid from the sticks who shows up with their suitcase and somebody gets injured and she's the star, you know. And Shirley Temple being, you know, the biggest tap dancer, and she's 6 years old. Also, like the American idioms, even, you know, people say you're tap dancing around the subject. That's not a compliment, you know.
No.
It means all flash, no substance. So there's something in the culture that's against it. And then maybe also just like the fact that it was so popular and then fell out of popularity. So there's also this sense of it being nostalgic or of the past, which is totally not true, but that's the impression.
Thank you. Thank you for coming back. You were once with the Prager Festival many years ago, 10 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
What comes to your mind? What do you feel when you see a book being produced and Brian wrote about it? What comes to your mind when you hear that?
I'm happy when people write about it because it opens it up to maybe those that are not experiencing it on a physical level or maybe even just from a musical level. I think if you're into reading books, and here's another one for you. I'm happy that I mean, the first book I think I heard of was Jazz Dance, which is Marshall Stearns, which you did quote. That was like the Bible, you know. And I remember when I discovered it, I was so surprised that somebody had even written something that in depth, you know. But it stops at a certain time.
Well, he died in 68.
Yeah. So then it's just like, oh, well, what happened after that, you know? So it's always nice to see somebody acknowledge the continuation of that.
Also, you're in it.
Yeah, I'm in it. For all of my descendants.
Yeah, that's like, it's kind of crazy. Anybody seen Hamilton? Yeah, that book, yeah, I know, right? But history has its eyes on you. The book, thanks. But anyway, yeah, no, I love it. I love that people are writing about it, that Brian has written about it. I like that Brian has written about it because he was there, like, you know, X-Wing 46, and he has an appreciation for it. And I think that is important. I think that that's kind of what's lacking is an appreciation for it in this kind of a way. And it's so interesting because everybody loves tap dancing. Like once they see it, there's some kind of nostalgic thing about it that, you know, everybody goes, oh, either I used to take tap when I was little, or my grandmother used to tap, or I love Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers. And so it has that, you know, that feeling. And so I'm happy that, you know, this is just another way to remind people that, hey, this is really quite a rich, intricate, sophisticated, beautiful, entertaining musical art form, you know.
You're here.
Yeah.
Ayodele, I don't know if you had a chance yet to read the entire book, but do you see yourself as a part of the history?
I just got the book on Thursday.
When do you see yourself as a continuation or as your generation that started new and had to reinvent itself?
Do I see myself as a continuation? Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, when you're learning it, you don't really think that you're going to. Yeah, at least for me, I didn't start learning it to think that I'm representing history and I'm gonna be in the next book. You don't really think of it like that. However, when you look back and you see that history and you see that cute little Harold going for it, really, like, that's incredibly difficult. Like, my heart, if I did that now, I think my heart would just come out of my body. But to recognize that you're part of such a rich lineage is it makes me very proud, you know. And so I like that I'm in the line somewhere, you know. I am thankful for that, you know, because I love it so much.
Brian, maybe also tell us a bit more about that moment when a street art form, a performance form, that really was almost an indigenous creation of perhaps slave dance, Irish dance, perhaps even a little bit German, in it. And all of a sudden it's in movies, it's Shirley Temple, it's Fred Astaire, and it took something away. And also black artists took a step back. Tell us a bit about that moment and what it did to the form.
Oh. I mean, I tried to get that a little bit earlier today. You know, the opportunities were. It's a racist society that's at part of American culture, and so the opportunities were not equal. I'm not sure what the question.
So Fred Astaire basically became a more famous tap dancer than.
Right, and they had many more opportunities. Not Fred Astaire. Fred Astaire is not a good example because he's an exceptional. He's like, for me, he's one of the greatest tap dancers, right? So it's not about him. It's about like Joe Schmo, regular white guy who wasn't so great, who got the opportunities that John Bowles, the greatest, did not get. That's really where the inequality comes out.
And I was also a bit rejected. Dancer didn't want to do that anymore, so it took also a reinvention.
Yeah, definitely. Certainly, Bill Robinson, who we saw in the 40s already, he was getting heckled by black audiences who would say, you know, we don't want that Uncle Tom stuff. And that became part of the legacy that black dancers in the 60s and 70s had to fight against, the sense of it being something shameful, connected with slavery and minstrelsy, and had to fight back against that to make it something that people were proud of again.
Yeah, first something was taken away and then put into a different context, and in a way it took away. So far, as I know, many black dancers tap dancers worked in the Oyster Bar in Grand Central, one of the few places where they could find work. The great Samuel Beckett, you know, would say how important. This, the silence or the steps were to listen to the steps. In many of his plays, you know, he choreographed even the steps and referred to tap dance, and that is like words. Some of his actors had to wear a sandpaper under their shoes in the rhythm of the steps were part of the words. And so he had a great, great admiration and of that great art form. Michael Jackson maybe was one who brought it also a bit back. Would you see him in that line of?
Oh, definitely. I mean, he's one of the great magpies in terms of just taking stuff from all over the place. But tap dancing is definitely a source of his.
May I interject? I think that Michael Jackson. Are you saying that Michael Jackson kind of brought?
I'm asking. I don't know.
No, I think that it's very evident that Michael Jackson loved that style. Like he loved Fred Astaire. You see him like always like move his feet in a tap. Like manner,
right?
And so like I think he was. It was so clear that he was so influenced by that visual, that you know, that elegance and that style. But I think who brought it back was Gregory Hines. Gregory Hines really like shone a light on it. He shined it like that. I mean, we were so fortunate to have him who was on his own journey as an entertainer, as an actor and dancer and, you know, performer. And then I am forever thankful for him because he used his
stardom
to shine a light on his idols, which were Sammy Davis Jr. and, you know, and all these dancers. So he brought it back. And if it weren't for him, I would dare say that, you know, I certainly wouldn't be here, you know. And a lot of these dancers would be Jimmy Sly, and they just, nobody would really, really know about them, you know, so thank you, Gregory.
Before we open up to questions from the audience, maybe put some light up, is there something in the book where you say, I wish I would have known more, I would have found this, is there something where you feel like...
There's always, research is infinite, yeah. So you just have to stop at some point.
So there's not something particular. I think it might be worth to talk a little bit of this kind of global phenomenon of tap dance and in our screenings. You know, we showed also examples from around the world. That even at the time, and perhaps was semi-dormant in America, became a hybrid art form in many countries. Maybe tell us a bit about.
No, anywhere you go, well, not anywhere, but there are very vivid tap scenes in Japan, in Germany, Brazil.
Finland,
you know. Stockholm, yeah, right? Like one of the big gaps.
Yeah, it's very good.
And what do you think of the level of the dance and those?
I just like that people are tap dancing and that they're inspired by it and they want to explore that for themselves. I think that ensures that, you know, it'll continue regardless. You know, people say, oh, tap is dying, tap is not dying, tap has never been dead, and tap is not gonna die. I mean, it'll be like the roaches, just die. One little, as long as there's one person. You know what I mean? It's never gonna die, yeah. So it's great, I like it. I think it's great.
A little weird privilege. So maybe you put up the light and we have such a great audience here, so maybe we have some questions. You turn us, and here's the one. We are recording it also, so we would like to ask you to speak into the mic. Okay. And please maybe say your name and to whom the question is.
Albert Gordon to either. I'd love to hear your observations about Sevier Glover and Gene Kelly.
You want to take Sevier and
Gene Kelly?
Sure, I can take both. Well, go ahead. My observations?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. You know, I said if it weren't for Gregory, I wouldn't be here. Well, if it weren't for Gregory, Sevier also wouldn't be here. Sevier is a very important part of the tap story. He kind of picked up where Gregory basically gave him a platform to expand the art form and introduce it to a generation of young people that were not tap dancing. You know, all of a sudden, young dancers.
They were in Michael Jackson, right?
And they saw this kid, and this cute little kid with, you know, and like that in the movie Tap, bouncing a basketball and doing some wings. And, you know, it was inspiring, you know, and it galvanized an entire generation of dancers. And for me, personally, I started tap dancing late. I was 19, I was in college, and I started dancing when Bringing the Noise, Bringing the Funk was being produced at the Public Theater, which was, I think, what really launched Sevier into stardom. But I saw that show, and I had been tap dancing for about a year before I saw that show, and I really liked it because I loved Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. That's why I wanted to take tap. And I saw that show, and it changed my life. I could not believe that that tap dancing could exist in that manner, you know, because I had seen it as and I loved it. I loved that. I loved the time steps. And then all of a sudden, here comes this guy. I was like, I wanted to do that. So, I mean, he's very, very significant as far as the evolution of it.
Now, you wanted Gene Kelly? Gene Kelly, I write about him a lot in the book. Very important person in the history of dance, but not a great tap dancer, in my view. If you watch them all, and I watch them all, you see the same rhythms over and over again, same steps. If you listen, you can like hear him falling in the same cliches. But the magic of Gene Kelly for me is how he can take these cliches and like electrify them so that you're like, you don't care they're cliches necessarily. Yeah. You love what he's doing. But not an innovator, not a jazz artist. The way Fred Astaire is, in my view.
I love Gene Kelly. I mean, I don't know if I would say he was an innovator. Well, maybe not an innovator as far as tap dancing is concerned. I mean, I think the vocabulary that he was using was very, you know, was pretty basic, but wow, he was a gorgeous dancer and very handsome. Very handsome. You know, but I don't think we can compare them, though, because I think they do two entirely different things, you know? Really.
I'll compare them.
Worlds apart, yeah.
Maybe one or two more questions. One, two.
I had a cousin who led Dames at Sea at the Louise Littell Theater and Paul Bukowski, and he was given the credit of bringing back tap dancing. There was no tap dancing there. And he called it all the cousins who still tap dancing was definitely got to be the coach.
Thank you.
Hi, Brian Graham Jones. If you could talk, and either both of you, about honeycombs and the copacetics. And then I was wondering, when you did your opening piece, mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure you only clapped your hands once. Uh-huh. And I'm kind of curious if you have any idea why you did, or when you feel the inspiration, because you clearly made, you know, those sounds with your feet, but why once would you, put my hand clap?
You think I did do a hand clap?
You did a hand clap once.
I don't remember it. I don't know. That's the beauty of improvisation. It's like you never know what's gonna happen.
Or even what you did.
Or even what I did. I don't remember. But I don't know. I think it really depends on the moment. And sometimes, you know, it's that. And sometimes it's more claps. And sometimes it's no claps. But I love rhythm, and I like being able to communicate a thought to whoever I'm dancing with, the dancing for. And I don't know, I clapped maybe because I was just feeling it. Honey Coles, elegance.
Yes. Honey Coles is a great Philadelphia dancer, and actually one of the figures that I use in the book and to follow the whole of his life. So you like meet him in the 30s. And then you see what happened in the 40s to him, and then you see him when tap falls apart, and he becomes the manager of the Apollo Theater, and then during those years is the group you're talking about, the Copacetics, which was formed at the death of Bill Robinson in 49, and it was a group of these guys just liked to hang out together, and they made a social club, and they weren't all dancers, but many of them were dancers, and through all these, you know, the dark ages of tap, they kept dancing, and they put on a charity event once a year. It was a big deal among the black elite. You can't find anything about it in the white press, but it was a big deal. And then when tap came back, you know, they were these old guys who were just immensely charming and became the elder statesmen, you know, of tap dancing in the late 70s and 80s.
Yeah.
Check it out on YouTube.
Copacetics are like, do any Latin music fans, like Fania All-Stars, anybody know about that? Anything about that? Oh, yeah. Fania All-Stars, it was like Hector Lavoe, the great vocalist, Celia Cruz, and all these fantastic, it was like All-Stars. That's to me what the Copacetics
are. All-Stars, right.
You know what I mean? It's just like all that fabulousness into one, in one performance.
Fantastic. Well, maybe one more, is there a question or a comment?
Oh, yeah, oh, wait.
Thanks for a great lecture. It was interesting that you were talking about a large Japanese group of tap dancers in the US, and I was wondering whether you included maybe Asian American and Latin American influence in the formation of tap dancing as a genre, because if we think about jazz history, it also originated as an African American form, but in after its legitimization in the white America, in the mainstream,
yeah,
US in the 1920s, the Latin jazz came along in the 50s and the Asian American jazz movement came along in the 70s. So I was wondering whether there's sort of similar trend in
tap dance. I'll go first, and you can say what you think. Not as much. I covered a little bit, but not to a great extent.
He's like, no. Okay. I'm from Puerto Rico. I say that, I don't know, I mean, are you asking whether or not there's been a contribution from that part of the world in particular, or just...
It's in the U.S., within the U.S., the Asian Americans.
I mean, there were, there was a group, a vaudeville duo, Toy and Wing, they were Asian American, I cover them in the book. But not a lot of figures that I was able to find.
In the origins.
Yeah, yeah, okay. That's what I mean.
I mean, now it's certainly grown. Max Pollock,
yes.
There's a lot of Afro-Cuban fusion with tap dancing.
Yeah. And even, back in the Palladian days, the 50s, which maybe you were talking about, the Mambo stuff, they borrowed from tap dancing. Mm-hmm. And but there was probably a little bit of exchange the other way, too.
Well, I would say we could have a little reception, or you can ask some questions. You have some. First of all, thank you for coming. David's lovely, and they're going to do a joint performance?
Yeah, we're not performing.
Will you ever have this critic, a New York Times critic dancing? And again, thank you. And I hope also soon, there will be an American Masters, or there will be a documentary. Ken Burns style on this great Great American Art Form. So please don't leave, it's going to be a 5-minute presentation, and let's clear the stage. Thank you.
Thank you.